We said, no, we'll see how it goes. It is the slum children who have protected this because it is their only space that they have. They protect it, they look after it, they come there in the evenings, they study there because they have no alternatives. It is precious to them. And today we use grey water from the buildings around to irrigate. The government has given us cheaper power. I'm no longer on the committee. We have moved away from corporate, but it still is there. What this second thing this did was it led to many other public-private partnerships in Mumbai. This was one of the first garbage dumps or open space, and then you had, of course, many, you have them all over the city now. So even if we can, all of us can do it, even in a small little space, this is what we're working on now. It is a slum near a school, and my own view that slum dwellers have to, they're there, they have to be respected. You cannot say that I'll make the park after I remove the slums. But how do you upgrade the slums themselves? So this is a school which has got this space over here. There's a lot of nefarious activities happening also. But we feel that if we sort of give them a sense of decency to working on the facade as well, and then create this park within, it would be nice. We're still trying to raise some money. Now with CSR, we will see what we can do. And then to come to one of my pet projects, which has not taken off. There was no political will. There was minimum bureaucratic will. But Mumbai has to look for things on a large scale if they're going to make a change. The Mumbai Esplanade project is something which I've worked with Professor Sidhu, who's a planner. And he and I have worked for the last 2 years on this, where we were, some of you may know about it, to create almost 50 acres of additional space within the heart of the city. You know, we all know the different maidans that exist. What is happening is we all know about 6 lakh people coming to the 2 train stations. And they literally fall out of the stations because of the cars. All over the world, everywhere. You can go to Europe, you can go anywhere else. You have these short underpasses. All that we said was, create a short underpass at Eros, create a short underpass in a couple of fountains, and then have a contiguous pedestrian walkable space right through from CST, through the Azad Maidan, right down to the Oval, ending up in the Khalagoda area. It was very viable, there was money available, but there was no political will to do this because they did not want to get rid of the cars, the car lobby is too strong, and we still have 6 lakh people falling out of our stations and having to go into these horrible underpasses which are filthy, which are not safe for women, which have no disability, access or anything else because the cars can't go. We worked out everything in great detail. We had technical people on board with us. All we had to do was create this short underpass between Churchgate and Fountain and then create a plaza near Eros building, and this would have been a plaza. And we could have created 2 or 3 plazas, one near the CST, one near the Eros, and it is possible. It's been done everywhere, everywhere. And this is how we could do it at BT station as well. The museum, what we suggested for the museum was to pedestrianize it. First they said that they would work with us. We worked with the improvement, and then we worked with the traffic people. And just when they said that we would try and pedestrianize one main street opposite the Prince of Wales, the Eastern Express Highway opened. And kaput, that was the end of it. So you can see what the priority is. The priority will always be the cars. Today I saw in the news how Paris is having a car-free day. So while many countries are going back to that, we are ruining our cities, removing our pavements, getting rid of anything that makes the city livable. So all you young people, you've got to fight for this. And we still can fight for pedestrianizing the museum plaza. And I hope we will be able to do. We got a lot of support from the press. It was very feasible. It was eco-friendly. The state actually cleared this and then went back. Well, the government changed or, you know, some excuse or the other. They want to build 100 smart cities. Let's make our cities smart that exist as well. We cannot negate that. And we were getting 51 acres of additional open space in the heart of the city, which adding to the 100 acres that exist would have given us about 160 acres for the lakhs and lakhs of people. And it's not elitist. They would say that South Bombay might be elitist. We have 6 lakh people coming into the city every day, into South Mumbai. How can it be elitist? They have nowhere to go at lunchtime, they fall off the trains and then they get back on the trains, they barely reach the destination where they can go. There is no, there are no alternatives for them, and this is what needs to be done. So we dedicated this, we hope that one day, somebody's lifetime, this will happen. So this was a picture I took in that house in Lavasa. You can see the bird there. So I want to tell you a story, some of you may have heard of it. There was a big, great big fire in a forest, and all the animals were running away. The lion was running away, everyone was running away, but there was a little bird. And that bird kept going to a lake nearby, filling its little beak with water, and going and trying to douse the fire. So the lion was laughing at the bird and said, "What do you think? You're going to put out this fire?" And the bird said, "Well, at least I'm doing my bit." So I said this story at another talk. And I was amazed when I got back to Mumbai. I got so many emails from people who told me the rest of the story. It's a folk story and I didn't know the rest. So apparently, the rest of the story is that the gods above saw this. And they saw this bird singeing its wings and, you know, really struggling to put out this fire, flying up and down all by itself. And the gods cried. And when gods cry, it is rain. And the rain put out the fire. So what I want to say is that I told you one story. We have 1 billion to go. Thank you.
Of a small museum and activities which people in that area could still use, so that it was not cut off completely. There have been some changes now in the municipal rules. All the time they're changing, so I think that is still being discussed. So that's one very important thing. As far as you know, all these buildings are rated LEED certification. In the sense that they're not glass blocks at all. This particular building has just windows and it's got balconies as well, even though it's tall. So the idea is that you can air condition the room, but the balcony area will be open. So like that, it's not a box like you have in BKC. But it is going to be very, very difficult to find high rises because of the cost and value of land. So I think it's very important that we architects don't just shy away from them, but rather address them and see what is it we can do to make them more viable, to make them more affordable, because they are going to come. We just don't have the land. We just don't have the land. So what are we going to do to make that? So there are many things that are done over here to make it as viable as possible. But certainly, there will always be controversy about this. But I don't think that we can have India growing without tall buildings. Tall buildings have to be built. So I think the quicker good and decent architects begin to work on them, I think it will be very important. So it's not a box. we have doors opening up, we have balconies. But although as you get higher and higher, it gets more and more difficult because of the wind, you know. So there are many, many complicated issues over here. Not so simple.
You start out the presentation by asking a very valid question: what is the role of an architect? And today, as we can see, there is a lot of specialization in each and every part associated with the building. And it's like 2-3 decades back, or maybe during the Victorian era, there was a term called as the master builder, where he actually brings in all the different craftsmen and people together. And that was his job, main primary occupation. So in today's context, what do you think is the role of an architect? And like as you mentioned before, he acts as a catalyst in the basically in the building process. So if you can just briefly elaborate on that, the basic role of an architect, apart from bringing the different professionals together.
I think every architect has to find their own role actually. The beauty of architecture is that it's such a broad profession in many ways. But essentially, I believe that we are guardians, we are not brokers. We're guardians of the built environment, we're guardians of the unbuilt environment. And we will always be peripheral to the country unless we get involved with more than just buildings. We have to go beyond buildings. Architects have absolutely no role to play in politics or in formulating policy or in governance or anything like that. They're not treated with as though they have the knowledge. I mean, when we have planning committees where you don't even have an architect on the committee, I mean, can you imagine in any other part of the world that? So how do we get our rightful place? We have to earn that respect. And we have to get that by developing practices and being activists and being people of change, who bring in change. So each one of us has to find a way that we can contribute to bring in that change. Otherwise, we're irrelevant. But as it is irrelevant to 95% of our population who don't need us anyway, we hardly cater to, you know, whatever, small percentage. So how do we become irrelevant?
So that just one more addition to that.
Do you think there is a specific role for critiques in architecture, especially in our times, to address this issue of the different kind of buildings that are coming up that we actually, you know, we're not happy with, in a way. So rather than expressing it in, say, in open forums, if we can write about it or say there's a definite profession regarding criticism, say a daily column or something like that, is that the need of the era? What's your opinion on that?
We are very scared to criticize ourselves or criticize each other. So I was in Goa once in a conference and I got together with four other architects and I said, let's crit our buildings. So they all looked at me and I said, you know, we begin by criticizing ourselves. So you can criticize my building, I'll criticize yours, you know, a positive criticism, but a constructive criticism. So they all said, yeah, great idea and everything. And then everyone went back, I came back to Mumbai, they went back to Delhi and everything. And I tried a few emails and then they all disappeared. We don't have the courage to have architectural criticism. And we don't have architectural critics of caliber that existed, whom you know, in many parts of the world. There's a famous one in New York, the woman. Anyway, it was a very, this slipped my mind. Senior moments come more often. And she was such a wonderful critic that even Corbusier was scared of her. And she was not an architect. Can you imagine any person in India who would have the courage to criticize some of the rubbish that is coming up all over? Or even if it's halfway good. I mean, if you have the confidence, you're open to constructive criticism. I think what is changing now is the media, online. I find that the online blogs and the online different sites are much more open in communication because they are more anonymous maybe. And I think that's what's going to change. things, and I hope your generation, and I find the articles that I read online are always bolder, they're more interactive than what you see in magazines or in books also sometimes. So I think that's what you guys have to take forward, and you have to have the courage to do that. It's very, very important. So so recently someone said, why don't you start it again? I said, oh my goodness, I think now I'm not going to do it. Let's leave it for the next generation to build up architectural criticism. We need courses in college. We need professors who can come and have the courage to criticize. What was wrong with Corbusier's buildings? What was wrong with Kahn's building? I am now restoring the Louis Kahn campus in Ahmedabad, you know, and I have met his children in New York, and we all revere him. But I know what some of the things that went terribly wrong, you know. So no one's a god, for God's sake, you know, and have the courage to say that, okay, it's a great campus, but these are some issues, and that's why we're having issues now, trying to restore the complex. But you need courage, you need knowledge, you need academic background, which the rigor, which is what Rashmi's been talking about. You need all that to be able to do it.
This one,
it has been a great presentation. I think you need a round of applause for bringing that to the August audience. Like you mentioned, railways and people falling out. We, about 10 years back, under the head of Dr. Usha Mehta Gandhian, we relocated 42,000 families falling from both sides of railways to a different place from World Bank funding. So that is a success story, which like one bird, draws us the miles of fire.
Absolutely.
So we are with you. If there is anything, we have a legal battle, we just went up to Supreme Court and did this enormous. We have done only first phase of relocating the slum workers, slum dwellers in other place. The second phase is yet to start. So we will probably need your help. Thank you.
Is the Rajabhai clock tower open for public viewing?
See, this is the point. That you restore and you rebuild and then the government doesn't open. I mean, you have tourists standing on the outside looking at it. Of course, you can go into the library. That's open. But you can't go up the clock tower. But special permission, okay. But it's wonderful. It's just 2 feet. The spiral is just 2 feet, and just one person at a time. You have to go up. And what's lovely is that in between you have many stops where you see the different mechanisms of the clock and how we have to protect the clock. And I was there about a month ago, and suddenly the clock decided to chime. All of us went deaf because it's so loud within it. But it's beautiful. It's really good. So it's open.
I was wondering what those craftsmen are going to do, those artisans, whether they're from Madhubani. I had a very simple question of what Madhubani painting, because I've got them to do our entire house, one of our very large section, and then the walls started cracking. And then the paintings were impossible to store. So I had to actually cover the whole thing again and get it really done. So maybe that was the nature of it, not supposed to be. There was supposed to be ephemeral anyway.
Absolutely.
So is this being understood that a lot of this work is really ephemeral? And why are we looking at it for posterity and not just seeing that it needs to be? And we were painting everywhere. Supposed to be painted over and repainted.
Absolutely. The one I showed you faded in the sun. And what I had done inside the house is perfect. What I did outside faded. And I called him back. Yeah. We gave him work. Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's got to be understood by whoever the owner of the places.
Yes.
That these are not meant to be permanent.
Absolutely.
And you're supposed to renew it.
That's how you can give them a lively love.
You do that. That's good. Are there any other questions? talking about criticism. This is a conversation that Brenda and I were having before the lecture today. Is that the need to understand political theory, to understand it, because one of the reasons why we don't have rigorous criticism is that because we're really not equipped for it. And it could be very banal. It needs a deep understanding of the subject. And I don't mean the subject of architecture, that's not what I mean. I mean the methodology. The how do you even sort of want to be, sort of what do you mean by criticism? What is it that you require to understand and study before you're able to even do that? And it has nothing to do with the discipline at all, of the particular discipline. Like this lady, this great critic,
Ada Louise Huxtable.
Oh yeah, that is yes. So yes, and it has nothing to do with her being an architect. It's just that she knew, she definitely had a working knowledge of what she was seeing, but she also had wherewithals of critical theory and criticism, and which is what we are trying to address at Yandrava, and which is where the conversation took us, that really we need that sorely in the city. We are doing it to some extent, but we intend doing a lot more, so that we are able to equip those who are looking and who do want to get a better sense and have the courage to then write boldly. And there's no two ways about it, that it is definitely the literary work that's going to take you forward. Absolutely.
And the essays have to be understood. Sometimes,
language.
We have cultural theorists. I can't understand a word of what they're saying when we go to hear them. And then I go out and I say, you know, excuse me, but did you understand? Make it simple. Make criticism understandable by general public. Only then is it going to be something that will have an impact. Will always be considered something that goes above our heads.
No job. No job. So, a big, big, big hand. Brenda's going to be on YouTube now, and so that those who couldn't come to the lecture, or you want to refer to what she said, is going to be there. Is that okay with you, Emma?
Yes, absolutely.
So thank you all so much for coming, and hope to see you soon.
Yeah.